Welcome. Ramadan Mubarak, everyone. My name is Jeffrey Bowden. I've been asked by Well, this is the wonders of technology. Just to repeat, I'm Ramadan Mubarak, everyone. My name is Jeffrey Well, it couldn't happen to a nicer chap, that's all I could say. I'm very honoured to have been asked by the Brighton branch of the Dialogue Society to host this event. We have a lineup of wonderful speakers for you this evening. And I'd like to start by quoting from that authoritative journal, Women's Own. Someone once said to Women's Own, there's no such thing as society. There are individual men and women, and there are families. No government can do anything except through people, and people must look after themselves first. And it's our duty to look after ourselves and then also look after our neighbours. That kind of throwaway philosophy, I think, has been exposed for what it is with the current crisis. We are living through an event in our lives, and possibly no one else has ever seen something like this, that has exposed the weaknesses of how we live and how we treat our planet. As small glimmers of light indicating that an end is to this crisis could be in sight, many of the speakers that you will hear from this evening, I'm sure, will talk about the opportunities that there are to recalibrate society and the values that have driven the nations over centuries. So without further ado, I would really like to introduce Isha Aaron from the Dialogue Society and hand over the platform to her. So Isha, over to you.
Thank you very much, Jeffrey, and good evening, everyone. I'm Isha, a research fellow at the Dialogue Society, and would, on behalf of the Dialogue Society, like to extend our greatest gratitude to you all for being here with us tonight. A warm welcome, and hopefully we'll have an evening full of community meaning, and I'm the luckiest of all to kick off the dialogue for tonight. Yeah, I think we could all wish we were together in a different circumstance, like we have been in Brighton for the past 15 years together. Our community iftar meals have been bringing us together since 2005. Engaging in the face-to-face dialogue that expanded beyond time and experience. But now we face something different. But yet again, we're still grateful that we can continue our work online, allowing us to expand and transgress now not only time and experience, but also space too. As many members of our communities continue to suffer from the COVID-19, we see the strength within community. Our partner organisation, the Fellowship Educational Society, has informed me that they've been given a grant to support 30 vulnerable migrant families in Brighton, to which they're going to be starting their work very soon, and that they've also done the same already and started in Basingstoke with 40 families. We may be perceived as having restricted in our community work and dialogue. It's the first time that we've been able to not come together to share this iftar meal. Maybe yes, not tonight. We're not together around a table, but our community volunteers and local Brightonians have been doing this, extending their compassion and service throughout this difficult period, not just tonight, but every single day. Now, why Ramadan? Why at the Dialogue Society have we been choosing the sacred Muslim month to come together as Muslims and non-Muslims? I think Ramadan has been an important time for the reflection of the work we do. We try our hardest to tune into the messages and significance of a cohesive society. And we think this is represented within Ramadan. To become Ramadanified, to become united across all our convictions, our faiths, beliefs, races, genders, and many more things that may seem to separate us. We believe Ramadan is the prime opportunity to embrace these all, to stand unified, stronger together as a community. So now we're coming towards the end of this period, period of Ramadanification, to become Ramadan, not necessarily an Islamic principle per se, but a process of becoming pure, of becoming human and connecting with our fellow humans. When we fast, we don't just limit our food and drink, but we are forced to review our acts and behavior. We are not allowed to get angry. We are retaught the values of community and looking out for those less fortunate. We are reminded of their pains, not just in hunger, but through reflection, the discriminations they may face, economic inequalities, and many more. But this COVID-19 pandemic has shown a different side of community that may not get the limelight as much. That we as humans in our very nature turn to each other for strength and for hope. Hundreds of thousands of us signing up to volunteer with the NHS and our unified Clap for Heroes across the whole of the UK are just a couple of examples. We've illustrated that we see the strength, love and community in our diversity. Not only as individuals, but as a collective community, we strive and succeed. And this social process of coming together shows that we need one another to learn empathy and care and to unify as Brighton. Just a couple of examples I'd like to share with you of our local community volunteers. One of our volunteers, Ibrahim Karadol, has showed such great altruism that he was recognised by the mayor of the city of Brighton and Hove, Councillor Alexandra Phillips. Many more of our community volunteers have been packing food packages and delivering them to frontline workers. And I'd like to share one of the kind words that has been shared. So, hi, I do not have words to describe the appreciation of you and your fellowship. The food was absolutely amazing, and so much of it. And the picture drawn by children melted our hearts. Many of us were in tears. The purses were so clever. Please, my sincerest thank you on behalf of the community mental health team for older adults. You truly are amazing in giving us strength to carry on with the job we care about. I think that that paragraph alone illustrates how our community coming together to support the perceived most vulnerable in society can make such a change to both the work they do and the spirit keeping their work alive. So yes, Ramadan has become a time of community for us at the Dialogue Society. It has become a paint, a unique paint that colours everything it touches and the hearts it touches. Community is a different colour during Ramadan, perhaps how it should always be, almost certainly how it should always be, but sometimes we forget. It's become a time in which we're reminded of this and our unity. Again, that holds and is painted a different colour. We are reminded of the necessity of the work we do and the unity of it all together, which I think as Brighton, we have here on display with this amazing panel of speakers tonight. So I'd like to thank you all once again for being here. And thank you, Geoffrey. I'd like to pass back to you now.
Thank you so much for that, Isha. We're going to have, you mentioned what Ramadan means, and we have a short video which explains it in a very compelling way. So, cue video. Right. Well, I thank the Dialogue Society for that video. There'll be a short test at the end of it to see how much you've all absorbed. I'd now like to introduce the new Mayor of Brighton, Councillor Alan Robbins.
I thank the Dialogue Society for that video. There'll be a short test at the end.
Oh, that's good. Okay, forget about the test. We're abandoning it. We don't have time. So what I would like to do is introduce Alan Robbins, who is the newly anointed Mayor of Brighton Hove, and I should mention Port St Lada, because he's a councillor in Portslade. So over to you, Alan.
Thank you very much, Geoffrey. Can you see or hear me? I can't see or hear me.
We can all hear you.
Jolly good. Okay, well, I'll push on then. And you've took the words right out of my mouth, because the first thing I was going to say was that this is my first engagement as Mayor of Brighton and Hove, and of course Portslade. And I never would have believed that I would be doing it remotely from my bedroom, or that I would cut my own hair for the occasion. And I'd like to apologise in advance if I mispronounce anything, but my old English teacher, Harry Steer, who was also a previous mayor of Brighton and Hove, used to tell me that I had my own set of vowels that I wielded like a weapon. So I'll do my best. As the mayor of the city of Brighton and Hove, I'm honoured to have been invited to speak by the Dialogue Society ahead of IFTA, which, if my sources are correct, will start as soon as the sun sets at 9:07 this evening. We need to acknowledge that Ramadan this year has been like no other Ramadan due to COVID-19 virus. The virus has challenged us as a society to come up with new ways of interacting. As social distancing rules have come into force, I am heartened by the way that in which citizens of Brighton and Hove have come together to think of novel ways to support each other. This virtual IFTA meal is a good example of that. Ramadan being a time of reflection, purification and prayer, the COVID-19 virus has given people of all faiths and none plenty to think about regarding the way in which we interact and live as a society and how we respond to the crisis. The theme of this evening is togetherness, or standing together. The question is how these themes can be demonstrated during the COVID crisis and social distancing. One simple gesture is to pick up the phone and speak to loved ones or those who are socially isolated. There are plenty of charities out there who will help by matching those who are isolated with volunteers willing to spend time talking to someone who is lonely. Just having someone to talk to makes a massive difference. Community Works is one of the charities that is able to match volunteers to organisations. There are many examples in the city that make you realise that at this time, people are standing together and working for each other. I would like to give you a few examples. Staff at West Hove Infants and Junior School, who have not only worked to keep the schools open for the children of key workers and for vulnerable children during the crisis, but have gone above and beyond to make it a positive experience for the children. A teacher in the school playing football with a pupil at break times because she was sad none of her friends were there. The head teacher greeting children and taking their lunch orders at the infant school. The PE teacher entertaining the kids during the holidays with boundless energy. And the infants teachers recording encouraging messages for the children on the home learning apps. Parents say that staff have been fantastic and reassuring for the children whilst putting themselves at increased risk by being at the school. This is an excellent example of standing together and making a positive contribution. Another story of standing together for the city is Vinod and Mina Mushroom, the couple who run a small shop in the West Hill area of Brighton, which they have kept amazingly well stocked throughout a time when there were empty shelves in other shops. They found new suppliers and always kept their prices fair. They introduced community deliveries with a group of volunteers delivering to residents who were unable to come to the shop. There are social distancing measures in the small shop, but a huge welcome from the owners and their staff to all people whose only daily journey out might be to the shop. This is an example of small things making a big difference to people's daily life. My last example is Sabri Ben Amiro and Rashida El Ristat, two people who have worked tirelessly in the past weeks to deliver and provide food for vulnerable refugees and migrant households, as well as cooking and serving meals for doctors and NHS staff at the Sussex County Hospital. Sabri and Rashida are leading members of the Muslim Forum in the city and work closely with Imrad Uthman and those within Madeira Mosque. At the very start of the lockdown, they contacted the network of international women to explain that they had begun to coordinate ordering of essential food in bulk and that they were delivering to those most in need. That included many families who are members of the mosque. But the scheme extended to include those women and their families who were referred by the network, and to the five Syrian families brought to the city through the Home Office and Brighton and Hove Council Vulnerable Persons Resettlement Scheme. In addition, food was delivered to the occupants of five houses of male asylum seekers during a weekend when those occupants had no food at all. They have continued to deliver food to many refugees and migrant households each week, and a few of those who receive deliveries are self-isolating as a result of contracting the COVID-19 virus. It is important to know that they are delivering to people whose first language is not English and for whom the difficulties of understanding government and local authority information is an added barrier to them feeling that they could go out at all, even when they don't have enough food for their children indoors. Meals have also been prepared and served for NHS staff in the Sussex County Hospital. These good people continue with their initiative and will do so as far as they are able in the coming weeks. The network and Voices in Exile, who support some of the resettlement scheme families, continue to refer for weekly food parcels. These are amazing role models to us all. I have only picked these examples among many other good deeds that have happened across the city. I hope that some of the community spirit demonstrated in these examples of caring for each other and charitable deeds will remain with us long after the lockdown has gone. May I now wish you all an enjoyable after meal and my best wishes, knowing that we all stand together, and even though you may be having your meal tonight in isolation, we are together in mind and spirit. Thank you for inviting me to share this special occasion with you all, and to the Dialogue Society for inviting me to speak. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much indeed, Alan. Everything perfectly pronounced, at least to my untutored and my untutored ear. Before I introduce the leader of the council, Nancy Platts, I'm going to just let you know there's going to be a slight change to the batting order. We have our three MPs lined up and waiting, but Peter Kyle has to be with his elderly dad at 8 o'clock, so I'm going to ask him to jump the queue at a socially suitable distance and speak ahead of Caroline Lucas. So, Peter, if you can get ready, then I can release you back in the community as quickly as possible. And then, so, Nancy, over to you to speak to everyone.
Thank you, Jeffrey. Ramadan Mubarak. Thank you for inviting me to this celebration. We have calcium in our bones, iron in our veins, carbon in our souls, and nitrogen in our brain. 93% stardust with souls made of flame. We are all just stars that have people names. That's from a poem by a young Asian poet called Nikita Gill. She was born in Belfast and grew up in New Delhi. And she's described as one of the most successful Insta poets with over 570,000 followers. And she's an up and coming young writer. I used her line of poetry because it reminds me that we're all very much connected. We're all of the same staff of the same world. However, we do not all experience the world the same. For young people, being a human being online is the norm. It's their world where they socialize, where they are successful as businesses, as entrepreneurs, and as poets. And it has recently become all of our worlds. At Ramadan, a time for coming together with family, friends, and community, a and sharing in the iftar. To do so online and not in person must be very challenging. And for Muslims on their own or without digital connectivity at home, the feelings of isolation are more acute. I would like to thank our Muslim community for everything that you do for residents of Brighton and Hove. Ramadan is a time of charity, compassion, abstinence, and forgiveness. Muslims, I appreciate that this is an integral part of your faith and does not come and go depending on the challenges being faced by the world. That said, despite how COVID-19 might be affecting you individually and as households, staying at home, loss of income, the work you are doing to ensure people do not go hungry and stay connected to each other is wonderful. Thank you. Last year, I had the honour of speaking. It was my first time attending the iftar dinner and my first time as leader of Brighton and Hove City Council. And I spoke of recognising my role as a political leader and that my duty, my responsibility and my commitment was to use the power it gives me to stand with communities against hate and division. There is no place for hate in our city, in our country. To stand up for those whose voices should be heard but often aren't because of discrimination, and to stand with our diverse communities, supporting your strength, your capacity, and your kindness. My commitment to this remains and grows. Sadly, we have lost too many lives to COVID-19 and too many Black and minority ethnic lives. And people have been pushed into significant financial hardship because of the impact of COVID-19, with an increase in food bank use and an increase in benefit claimants. The impact of the virus has highlighted the inequality that Black and minority ethnic communities know and experience. While we must all stand together to overcome the virus, while we are all in it together, we must recognise that we are not all experiencing the impact and loss the same. It is by far much worse for some communities than for others. Black and minority ethnic communities, for residents living in our most deprived communities, recovery means very different things for different people. And tackling inequality and discrimination must be at the heart of our city's recovery planning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Nancy. We've got a sort of clash of diaries. So I hope that Peter can get through his party piece right now, because he has to go and join his dad, who's in isolation and quite elderly. And we've also waiting for the imam to come. So, so Peter, please speak to the nation.
Thank you, Geoffrey. It is an important time for all of our families, and it is a very important part of being together, is actually thinking and reflecting about how we do that. If my dad heard that he had been described twice as elderly tonight, I think he would take exception to it. My dad is very many things, including his age, and I think he wants to be known for all of those things as well. But look, this is a very strange experience for all of us, and we're all learning to come together in very, very different ways. I didn't even know what Zoom meant. I didn't know what it was before this epidemic started to reach across the world and lap the shores of our own country here. And we've been coming together, and I've been meeting new people in our own community here by talking to many businesses and talking to people across the different sort of constituent parts of our community. So we are finding new ways of coming together, but also we are also reflecting on what is dividing us. And considering that tonight's iftar dinner, and thank you so much to the Dialogue Society for finding a way to bring us together despite all of the very many challenges. So you've played a really key role ever since I became a candidate way back in 2013. You've played a very key role in bringing us together, not just in order to meet each other and bring us together across faiths and people of no faiths, but also by issues as well, and bringing us to talk and discuss and share perspectives on different issues. And that is absolutely essential, because when I think about what the tonight's iftar dinner is about and the subject is about, and about bringing us together from around the world, then there is one key thing that we cannot fail to see right now, and that's that globally, we're not coming together, even though as individual citizens, thanks to religions, thanks to different organizations, we are as individuals coming together and sharing and meeting, but actually as countries and as nations, we're not. And I think when we look back to our history, particularly over the last century, when we had two world wars, it's very interesting to reflect on the First World War, where we failed to come together as a country, as a globe, and find global solutions to the issues which led to the First World War and were the consequences of the First World War. The consequence of not coming together as a globe was the Second World War. After the Second World War, we devised a way to come together as a world of nations and start tackling the big issues. Well, we've seen in recent years, because of the rise of populism, because of the rise of nationalism and some of the other security challenges that we faced, that we as a globe are fracturing as a group of nations. And this is something that I think has been laid bare by coronavirus, because the only way that we are going to be able to find our way through as a country and as a globe is to work together and then share the learning, to share the resource that we develop through our scientific, through our social, and through our political ways forward and the political tools that we devise. And that is the only way forward. So I hope that we can come together more, not just as communities, but as countries as well. And I can say that I am going to work very, very hard to try and make that a reality, because I think that's a burning challenge that we face for our times. And although that I am the Member of Parliament for Hove and Portslade, I know full well that the community here really expects me to be thinking not just locally, but also nationally, but also globally as well. And that's something that I'm very happy to commit to all of you tonight. Thank you for having me again. I hope the rest of the evening is really wonderful, but I will be joining my family pretty shortly.
Thank you very much, Peter. Do wish your dad, your young at heart dad, and the rest of your family well from all of us. And without further ado, I'm going to release you back into the community where you can do that, probably virtually, and introduce, before we go to the Imam who's joined us, Mubarak Ramadan Imam. Nice to see you there. So if I can just ask Caroline Lucas to share some thoughts with us now.
Thanks so much, Jeffrey, and Ramadan Mubarak. Thank you so much for inviting me to share in this iftar with you again, albeit in very different circumstances. You know, these evenings are always such a wonderful example of how much can be achieved in the name of unity, with one community within our wider community opening its doors in the spirit of friendship, bringing people together to celebrate and helping us to make lasting connections for the future. Never have these connections been more important than in 2020. And frankly, whoever chose this year's theme of togetherness chose extremely wisely. Over the past few months, we've become very used to the phrase social distancing, but actually the lockdown has made us keenly aware that whilst we may have to be physically distant from each other, we still have a deep human need to be as close to each other socially as we can, to be together. We have, I think, a renewed appreciation of the value of coming together to share food and conversation, and many of us are lucky enough to have the technology to be able to do that virtually. Now, I know that bringing people together is at the very heart of the work that the Dialogue Society does, and I want to thank you for all you do to promote community and mutual understanding in our city and beyond. Here in Brighton, we're proud to be an open and diverse city and one of the glimmers of light to emerge from the darkness of the past few months, I think is how the city has opened its arms even wider in such an inspiring way. We've seen new community groups spring up and existing ones grow. We've seen people who didn't know their neighbors before now making new and lasting connections, stepping forward to help those in need, whether of food or practical help or friendship to counter isolation. And I think that's just such a huge source of hope, really, to see that. the way those mutual aid groups just leapt into action. They didn't wait for permission from the government or the council or anyone else. They just got on with it. Thousands of people coming together and showing leadership when it really mattered. And I think that really is truly inspiring. We've also seen, I think, a renewed gratitude for the vital role played by key workers in our society. And we've been reminded that too often the people who are paid the least are actually doing the most important jobs. I hope when this crisis passes, we won't forget how much we owe to those people who have worked so hard, in some cases risking their own lives, to keep us healthy, to keep us fed, to keep our buses moving, to keep our bins emptied. Because while we're all weathering the same storm, it's pretty clear that we're not all in the same boat. This crisis has shown again how unequal our society is. We've seen the huge economic inequalities laid bare. We've seen our Black and minority ethnic communities have been disproportionately affected by COVID-19. It's right that the government has announced an inquiry into this issue, but I don't think we should wait to learn the lessons. We need to be doing that right now as we go along. So I agree with the NHS Federation's call for further and more immediate action now to mitigate risks to the BAME communities and to health and care workers. The coronavirus crisis has changed everything. It's reminded us who and what really matters in our lives. Yes, it's laid bare the profound weaknesses of an economy which has systematically eroded our collective social immune system. But it has also shown us that many things that we were told were impossible or unrealistic are in fact possible. You know, the government can house people sleeping on our streets. The money is there for the NHS when we need it, and we can provide an income for people who aren't able to work. And that's what makes it so important that we don't even think of going back to how things were before. Business as usual didn't work for the vast majority of people, and it was trashing the natural environment on which we depend for our very survival. We can and we must redesign our economy and our society so that it meets the needs of everyone for food, shelter, care, health, dignity, financial security, irrespective of employment, ethnicity, or nationality. And we can and must redesign our economy and our society such that we are able to have a thriving environment and nature going forward in the future. That won't necessarily be easy, and we may not always agree on the steps that we need to take. But if we can harness the togetherness and the shared purpose that we've seen during this crisis, and which you as a dialogue society have always exemplified, then I believe that we can do it together. So I'm so looking forward to a time when we can all gather in the same room again, share food and share stories, celebrate the breaking of the fast in person. But until then, thank you so much for inviting me. And I hope very much that you and your loved ones are all keeping safe and well.
Thank you so much, Caroline. Waiting in the wings to follow those inspiring words are some reflections and prayer from Iman Uthman Jiba. You are very welcome. I know you have limited time to be with us. So I'll hand over the camera to you and the microphone. Thank you, Caroline, and thank you, Iman.
Thank you very much. once again, I think it's an honor to be with such honorable and esteemed guests, to see familiar faces, even though it's over the screen. We're so used to talking face to face, but I think the current situation has allowed us or has taught us how to adapt and how to change. The few minutes that I have, I just wanted to share something quite inspiring and something quite interesting. I'm an avid reader of history, and situations like the current situation that we are going through were quite common in our history. So when we analyze history and we read about how people dealt with pandemics and how they dealt with epidemics, for us it's an opportunity to learn from history. And I believe that 30 or 40 years down the line, or possibly hundreds of years down the line, people will look back at 2020 and look at the response of communities, that what did the community do and how did the communities react to the pandemic or to the situation? Was there, was there a community spirit? Did the people help one another? Was there any sort of solidarity? And from a historical perspective, one of the, I think, greatest pandemics in our history was possibly in the 14th century, which was quite commonly known as the Black Death. Until quite recently, the Black Death was has been discussed in European history, but until quite recently, it did not have much. You can say it did not have much exposure when it came to the Middle East. A recent a historian by the name of Michael W. Dolls has managed to write regarding the impact of the Black Death within the Middle East. And a very interesting observation that he made whilst exploring Islamic texts or the texts of Islamic historians such as Ibn Kathir and of Damascus and Ibn Battuta of Morocco. A very interesting incident which he mentions, and I think for us it's something which we can reflect upon and something which we can learn from. Ibn Kathir and Ibn Battuta, they both write that during the Black Death, the Black Plague in 1348 or 1349, where historians mention that approximately 50% of the entire world population died as a cause of this pandemic. They mention a very interesting incident which took place in Damascus. They mention that in Damascus, when the death toll started to rise, and it started from 100 deaths a day, and then to 200 deaths a day, then to 300 deaths a day, they say that on Monday, the 21st of July, 1348, an announcement was made that people should fast for 3 days. Now, this announcement was made generally for the Muslim community. And what happened is that the Muslim community, they fasted on a Tuesday, on a Wednesday, and on a Thursday. On the Thursday night, many people spent the night in the mosque engaged in prayers and worshiping God. And in the morning, after the morning prayer, people, they came out and they went to and they moved in the direction of a specific mosque, which is translated as the Mosque of the Foot. And the belief at that time was that this mosque, it held or it had the footprint of the Prophet Moses. So it was regarded as being an interfaith site, which was visited by the Muslims of Damascus, but also the Christians and the Jews. What Ibn Kathir, what he writes, he says that on that morning, or after the morning prayer, on Friday morning, people, they came out of their homes. Now, of course, the whole social distancing wasn't something which was practiced at that time. But he says that approximately 40,000 people came out of their homes. And it was a mixture of Muslims, Christians, and Jews. They each came out with their own scriptures. So the Muslims came out holding the scriptures of the Quran. The Jews came out holding the Torah, and the Christians came out holding the Gospels. And they all moved together in the direction of this mosque, all of them engaged in prayer. And there was a feeling of unity amongst the inhabitants of this city. They engaged in prayer together from morning until midday. And then they mention that as a cause of this. Now, historians, of course, they look at causes and consequences. So they say that as a cause of this, God caused the affliction to be lifted from the people, and the number of deaths started to decline. Now, the reason I mentioned this incident was in times like that, where communities actually came together, and regardless of their beliefs, regardless of what and who they believed in, there was this sense of unity. There was a sense of working together. There was a sense of purposefulness that each person within the community thought about the next person, and they all came together, and they all decided that working together would be the best way to move forward. And looking at this as well, and looking at the current situation within Brighton and Hove, and members of the community will tell you that we see that there are churches and mosques and synagogues and people of faith and people of no faith that are working together to provide support within our city. Just from the mosque ourselves, there seems to be a food bank which started at the beginning of the lockdown. And regardless of faith and regardless of language or regardless of where you come from, we have people from all backgrounds accessing this service. And it just feels like, and it just feels, it feels so good just giving something back to the community. And especially during the month of Ramadan as well, where Muslims are encouraged, and it is emphasized that the month of Ramadan is a month of giving. It's a month of charity. It's a month of being conscious and being aware of those that are less fortunate than yourselves. And within the Islamic teachings as well, you have teachings of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, such as his statement where he says that person is not a true believer who eats to his fill whilst his neighbor is hungry. Taking the spirit of charity into consideration, we are seeing all across the board, from people from various parts of the city, people who adhere to various faiths, that they are reaching out to help those that are less fortunate. So even though the situation might be quite dire, what we are seeing, moments of brilliance. We are seeing moments of generosity. We are seeing moments of solidarity and unity. And we hope that these qualities that we are achieving during these trying times, we hope that we can continue, and we can keep this community spirit ongoing beyond this current tragedy, we continue to come together in solidarity and in unity. And our previous speakers have mentioned that hopefully next year our next iftar we will be speaking, and we will be communicating once again face to face, and we will be breaking bread together once again, and we will be enjoying your fantastic presence once again as well. Thank you very much.
Now, I've just followed instructions from Mahmoud and unmuted myself.
Okay.
It's very good for me to shut myself up occasionally. We now have, thank you so much, Iman, and I know you have to rush to your next engagement. You're two minutes over your deadline.
Thank you very much.
But we're very grateful for you for joining us this evening and telling us those inspiring thoughts, and also the history of some of the previous pandemics and how it was dealt with. There are many parallels. So thank you so much again. We now have a bit of a treat, and I'm going to introduce, before I introduce Afra Nur, and I'm going to say this very carefully because I don't want to mispronounce her, Afra Nur Dolozian, probably mispronounced it. We have an example of a Muslim art form, which goes back, this is Ebru art, which goes back to the 15th century in Central Asia. I'm going to hold up a book. I don't know whether you can see this, but this is a book out of my little library. And many people have seen that kind of thing in a flyleaf before. And you think, well, how do they do that? Well, this goes back to the 15th century in Central Asia. It was taken on by the Ottoman Empire in the 17th century and developed by more artists there. And then when people started traveling to the Middle East from Europe, It found its way into our everyday lives and in books like this. And I've got another one here, which, you know, I just randomly took a few books out of my library. And, you know, here we are, another example of this kind of art form. But now our artist in residence, Afra, is going to show you. She's fasting at the moment. She can't speak and do this this skillful art and talk at the same time. So I'll tell you just in advance of this, the water that you see on the screen now is prepared, and I'm going to read because she briefed me here, with seaweed. The paint is mixed with water and ox gall, which is a byproduct of coal. And she is using handmade brushes from horsehair and rosewood, and the sticks for the patterns. So you'll see her disturbing the fluid with the sticks. And if you want to know more, she has a website, which is www.ledetail.co. Nothing else on the end. She's also on Instagram with ledetail.co. So over to you, Afra, and show us what you do. Well, that was absolutely amazing. Eat your heart out, Jackson Pollock. That's all I can say. This is where he got that idea from. So Anna, thank you so much. That was wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you so much for inviting me. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did. Great to be a part of this event.
And it's wonderful to have you with us. No animals were hurt in the production of this artwork, except for the horse's tail, no doubt. Then you comb a horse's tail and you can make those brushes. Thank you so much again. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now we turn to the third of our MPs. You wait for one MP to come along, and then all of a sudden three come along in one go. And bringing up the rear of our MP trio is my local MP, the wonderful Lloyd Russell-Moyle. Over to you, Lloyd.
Thank you very much, Geoffrey. Look, I think this is a great event, and we had hoped this year to be hosting our first Dialogue Society Iftar in Parliament. Of course, that was not to be, but I'm sure next year we will get around to organising that, as well as the usual and regular one that we have down here in Brighton. These events are always important, but this time now with COVID allows us to contemplate where we want to go and what kind of world we want to see. To quote a former leader of the Labour Party, maybe slightly out of context, but I think relevant now, to some extent, COVID has meant that the kaleidoscope has been shaken. The pieces of our society are now in flux, and they will settle again. But before they do, let us reorder this world around us and use modern science to provide prosperity for all. Science, Tony Blair this is, of course, went on to say, can't make that choice for us. Only the moral power of a world acting as a community can. And I think that's important. We hear a lot about science leading the response from this government, but many of these issues are moral issues. They are issues about us making choices together as a community. And that is, to some extent, what COVID must require for us, to come together as a community, as it has in the immediate, but now I suspect for the long term. And in my view, we don't need to reinvent the wheel, although new forms will come, whether they be Zoom calls or whether they be other forms of communication. And just like you saw that piece of art there, an old, age-old technique, that technique is now used to put paint patterns on car bodywork, adapted for the modern or the 20th century era. I suspect as we go into the middle part of the 21st century, we would move away from cars. But what we now need to decide is what kind of society we want to live in. There will, of course, be some immediate decisions, social care, how do we look after the most vulnerable? And what is clear is that we have a society where we are not all in this together. COVID, as others have already mentioned, has broken this myth, I hope once and for all, that everyone is equal in the nation. We know Black, Asian, and minority ethnic people are more likely to die of COVID. We know people in inner cities where air pollution is poor are more likely to suffer and catch it. We know that those working, saving our country at this time, are more likely to be low paid. And those who can't work from home and have to follow the instruction of the government to go out to work are more likely to be manual workers that have lower life expectancy. So if we want to reform this world, what kind of world do we want to be? A world, I hope, where we come together using our digital prowess, using our ability to communicate virtually, but also one where we communicate in person. This is something that I think COVID has done a great deal about. I've spoken to my neighbours more than I have in a great deal of time. I think many of us have. And so whilst we have been locked up physically, it doesn't mean that we have been unable to communicate in the local. And you see that, of course, the East Brighton Food Co-op, the Salt Dean COVID Support Group, the Bevy in Morecambe's food delivery service. They're all examples of the local building resilient communities. But the question has to be asked, why were those things needed in the first place? What had we done so wrong that meant that food poverty was rife in our society? How had we failed to look after our communities, whether they be in cities or Black and ethnic minority communities? And coming out of this, those temporary solutions cannot be long-term solutions. Now, Ramadan is a great time to contemplate, to think and consider. And whether you do that as a Muslim through prayer, or whether you do that as another religion or no religion at all, contemplation, consideration is important going forward. But that contemplation doesn't need to be alone. And sometimes it needs to be together, together internationally and within our community. I think we can build a new social contract for our society, but it can be only one in which we build a dialectical discussion where we come together and share ideas. And in that process, brand new ones are created. I know that we can do that. And I know that there are things that we can take inspiration from. And Ramadan provides a moment, to some extent, where many of the rest of us who are not Muslims have forgotten or failed to do over decades, which is to come together in community, take time to contemplate, and take time not to just consume, but to consider and consider others. So togetherness and consideration, I hope, is something that we will all take from this Ramadan. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Lloyd, for sparing the time to join us tonight and for those words. I think we all agree that we really do need to recalibrate society urgently. I await with abated breath to see whether we do and whether we slip back into old ways too quickly. Let's hope we learn something. Waiting very patiently in the wings is a member of the Blue Night Service, Nick May, who is from our police force, who've had the unenviable task of having to interpret government pronouncements. Nick, perhaps you'd like to share with us your thoughts. And thank you again for waiting so patiently.
Thank you so much for the invitation to this rather unusual Ramadan celebration. I think this is the fourth or fifth iftar event that I've attended, arranged by the Dialogue Society. Firstly, in my role as faith and belief lead for Sussex Police, but now I have the real privilege of also being the divisional commander for Brighton and Hove. And it's really an honour to be invited today just to say a few words, and it will only be a few words. COVID, I think, has been a real test for community cohesion, and other speakers have already addressed that to a large extent. Stresses, strains can lead to a blame culture and can lead to fractures in that community cohesion. I have to say that in the city of Brighton and Hove, and some really good examples have already been given, I've seen the vast majority of cases, communities coming together, helping each other, helping people within their own communities, and reaching out. And it's been extremely heartening for me to see that. From a policing perspective, we feared a rise in hate crime, reports of hate crime. And that's clearly a risk, and it continues to be a risk. To this date, to this time, we have not seen that in the city of Brighton and Hove. We are monitoring it really closely. And of course, you would expect that we take this extremely seriously. But at the current time, we have not seen that rise. But there is no, this is absolutely no time for complacency in that regard. The vast majority of people and communities in Brighton and Hove and across Sussex have responded extremely positively to the very challenging circumstances and the extraordinary circumstances. I think many people have shown, the majority of people have shown a great deal of social responsibility in complying and working with some very strict and unwelcome guidance in almost every respect, albeit people tend to understand why some of these restrictions have been put in place. There has been really good compliance with the health regulations about social distancing, gatherings of people from different households, and in many occasions, especially when we're thinking about people of faith communities, that's been there's been an absence of the Muslims have been unable to gather together in prayer over this Ramadan period. Christians, Jewish people have been unable to gather at their worshipping places, and of course other communities will feel the same. And so people have had to adapt and have made sacrifices during this time. I think and I hope that in years to come we'll look back at the event, we'll mourn the loss of those who have died. Hopefully we will learn some or all of the lessons about how we as a nation have responded. But I also hope we'll look at it at a time where we came together whatever the full impact on, and it clearly does, the COVID does impact on different communities in different ways. I hope that we'll see some sort of spirit of pride in the way that we have come together. And that this will lead on to a different approach perhaps next time. So just to conclude, on behalf of Sussex Police, I'm really grateful that we've been invited and I've been invited to speak again. I can assure you that the officers and staff of Sussex Police and Brighton and Hove Division specifically, which is the area that I lead, are working for all communities in Brighton and Hove 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. We are out there, the staff and the teams are doing their very, very best for the people of Brighton and Hove. And thank you again for the invitation.
Well, we thank you and the rest of the Blue Light Services who have been working their socks off for the community in very difficult circumstances. And now, as they say, for a short musical interlude, we turn now to our friend John Williamson, who is sitting poised with his fingers over the ivories over at St. Peter's Roman Catholic Church. He's going to play, hopefully not chopsticks, but something a bit more elevated than that. So over to you, John.
Thank you. Good evening. I'm not actually at St. Peter's. This is my home. I'm in lockdown, being elderly enough, chronic disorders. So I'm optimistic. This is going to end. So two tunes, Somewhere Over the Rainbow, Skies Are Blue, and I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. There's great swathes of Brighton and Hove society would have been donning their ruby-rigged shoes. And of course, a lot of people have been taking off their hats to Dame Vera Lynn at 103, the oldest person now to have a record in the top 10. She lives in Sussex amongst us. And no doubt your rendition means that more royalties will go into her pot somewhere, her pension pot. Thank you so much, John. That was really wonderful. Right. Okay, a lot of feedback here. So now we turn to Rabbi Andrea Zanardo, who is sitting waiting there patiently to share with us his thoughts. So over to you, Rabbi.
Thank you to the Dialogue Society for giving me, for the first time in my life, the opportunity to join with Muslim and non-Muslim friends for the iftar and Shalom Aleichem to everyone. Shalom is probably the most known Hebrew word. Sometimes it's translated as hello. Sometimes it's translated as peace, just like the cousin word salam. But shalom doesn't mean exactly peace. It means completeness, being serene, being united with your fellow, your neighbor. I have, thanks God, younger children. I spend time with them during this weird months of isolation. And I see them interacting with their friends over social media, over telephone and all the other things that they are more able than me to handle. Sometimes I wonder what they will tell when they will become adults to their friends, to my, God willing, grandchildren over these days, of these weeks. And I hope, I pray that they will tell how in this month, in the community of Brighton and Hove and Portslade, the various communities have discovered the values of shalom, of working together, of being united, and have set the foundation for a future of shalom, of peace. And this is my wish to everyone. Aleichem shalom, shalom aleichem, and Ramadan Karim.
I thank you very much. I apologize to anyone tuning in. I think the rabbi had his YouTube channel.
No, I haven't.
Oh, well, we had you twice over. So it was a double bonus that we heard you twice. But don't worry. These things happen. It happened to me in the beginning. And if it can happen to me, it can happen to absolutely anyone.
Anyone tuning in, I think the rabbi had his YouTube channel.
Okay. I now turn to my old friend, the Reverend Anthea Ballam, who is going to share with us her thoughts. Thank you again, Rabbi, and good night for the moment. We've got 5 minutes before the iftar dinner will be broken in households across the city. So over to you, Anthea.
Well, I shall speed along here. First of all, I'd like to say Ramadan Mubarak to everybody. Can you hear me okay, Geoffrey?
We can, I can.
That's good. I've turned the volume down so we don't get any doubling of sound. Well, my name is Anthea and I'm the chair of the Interfaith Contact Group of Brighton and Hove. And this is an organisation that for 25 years has brought people of faith and none together in harmony and peace and understanding. And I'd like to open with some heartfelt thanks. Firstly, to our new mayor, Councillor Alan Robbins, because although he's historically the patron of the IFCG, he's much more than that. Very importantly, our new mayor has conferred a groundbreaking honour to the IFCG. He's made us his chaplain. And to have an organisation serve the mayor in this way is absolutely without any precedent. It means that Councillor Robbins has, as mayor, citizens of all faiths and none. Our committee alone includes members of the Buddhist, Baha'i, Islamic, Christian, Jewish, pagan, and atheist communities. And all of these people and their communities will be serving him. So this is really important, and I really have to thank him for this gesture of faith. I'd also like to thank our hosts, the Dialogue Society. They are totally amazing, as we all know. Mahmoud Gunaydin, particularly, I have to thank. He has served the interfaith movement in our city with extraordinary imagination and generosity. And I'd also like to express my thanks to the MPs, Caroline Lucas, Peter Kyle, who's not there now, but still I'd like to thank him, and Lloyd Russell-Moyle. And also thanks to Nancy Platts, the leader of the council, who, like our MPs, has cared for this city with extraordinary compassion and skill. We are truly blessed with these people. Believe me, I don't think everybody has people of such quality helping them and their communities. So thank you all so much. And I'd also like to thank Nick May, because at the moment we're running a special thing called Words of Connection, which is words for people which we're sending out and going to film and do all sorts of things. And this is made possible by a grant from the police, very generously, which literally came overnight to support us. And I really have to thank the police for that. So we owe lots and lots of thanks to lots of people. And last, and by every means least, I have to thank our master of ceremonies this evening, Geoffrey Bowden, if only because he and I have been hanging out since Queen Victoria came to the throne in June 1837. And we both remember this experience very, very well indeed, both Geoffrey and I. On a more serious note, this year's Ramadan is going to be a really tender moment of spiritual reflection. The emphasis on family gatherings and sharing has been so horribly undermined by the lockdown. And of all spiritual practices, I know that fasting teaches lessons that many of us may have forgotten, certainly not the Islamic community. It is the greatest possibility of discovery and self-discovery of all through fasting, which is self-sacrifice. We don't think about self-sacrifice in our society, and we certainly don't think about how choosing to fast makes one more mindful, but I know it does because my friends in the Islamic community have explained this to me. It really is amazing to make one mindful and think of others, and think of others who are just not so well off or cannot find food. It really is an amazing time for opening people's minds and getting to think about others in a compassionate way. Today, the burden of sacrifice weighs particularly heavily on those who live alone. And every day they experience one of the horrible punishments that actually are given out to people in prison, so solitary confinement. Yet across the world, people are voluntarily accepting solitary confinement for the good of others and discovering the meaning of self-sacrifice. So for this reason, I would really like to offer just a very brief prayer for those that fast and also those that may be hungry, made hungry by the harsh events of life itself. And the prayer is followed by a blessing for the inner history of a day by the great John O'Donohue, the Irish poet, priest, and philosopher. So this is very quick for all of you. This is a moment of prayer for those who experience hunger by faith or circumstance. May that hunger pass. May the spirit of surrender be a stepping stone to a moment of discovery on the journey of life. May compassion and sacrifice be companions to us all. And when the journey is made, may the ways of those gentle paths become evident, so we can learn to trust that in life and death, there is always love, love without end. And the blessing for the inner history of a day by John O'Donoghue goes like this. No one knew the names of this day. Born quietly from deepest night, it hid its face in light. Demanded nothing for itself, opening out to offer each of us a field of brightness that traveled ahead, providing in time ground to hold our footsteps and the light of thought to show the way. The mind of the day draws no attention. It dwells within the silence with elegance to create a space for all words, drawing us to listen inwards and outwards. We seldom notice how each day is a holy place where the Eucharist of the ordinary happens, transforming our broken fragments into an eternal continuity that keeps us. Somewhere in us, a dignity presides that is more gracious than the smallest thing, that fuels us with fear and force, a dignity that trusts the form a day takes. So at the end of this day, we give thanks for being betrothed to the unknown and for the secret work through which the mind of the day and the wisdom of the soul become one. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anthea. And poor old Queen Victoria was never quite the same after meeting us. Anyway, I would like to say to all our Muslim viewers who have been following this on YouTube, happy fast breaking. The iftar is now happening. In fact, it started 3 minutes ago. And without further ado, I'd love to introduce the Most Reverend Jerome Lloyd as our next and final speaker.
Ramadan Mubarak, peace be with you all. Thank you for the invitation to share with you this evening and for managing to find a way to host something that has become a Brighton institution, really, iftar dinner every year. And as a Christian, may I say how much we understand your present situation. COVID lockdown happened towards the end of Lent, our period of fasting, sacrifice, and contemplation, and was fully enforced during our Holy Week, the most important week for us of the year, and of course for Easter, preventing us from being able to break our fast together after our intense period of holiness and prevent us from celebrating a great feast. So I have a lot of sympathy, and I know Christians, many Christians, share a lot of sympathy with you for this time of difficulty and compromise observing your holy month. As chair of Brighton and Hove Faith in Action, it has been my privilege these past few weeks to witness and assist civic, statutory, and voluntary sector partners come together from across the city and wide spectrum of communities to address the many and varied issues and challenges this unprecedented coronavirus crisis has thrown at us all. While the various faith communities have not been able to worship respectively and collectively in their venues, it's been amazing to learn and share in our weekly Zoom get-together the inventive ways they have addressed the problem of communication, collective worship, and the needs of others. From utilizing modern technology, such as we are right now, to facilitate prayer services, study groups, and checking in with each other, through to rallying and coordinating volunteers and forming partnerships to deliver essential services to ensure that no one is left behind. Having been privileged to attend meetings, strategizing and coordinating relief efforts for the most vulnerable in our city, the homeless, the elderly, the lonely, the sick and infirm, I am proud to say that our city of Brighton and Hove is truly a compassionate place to be. I've also been fortunate too in my current role internationally for our church to have witnessed the same compassion and willingness to work together repeated in countries and communities across the globe. From the Philippines in Asia, where I happened to be just as the coronavirus was breaking out from China, to our missions in South Africa, Americas, India, and our parishes in the States and in Europe. In every place, a great outpouring of compassion and goodwill has prevailed to ensure everyone is safe, cared for, and comforted. Everywhere, people of faith or no faith have come together in partnerships to meet the needs of others. As awful and insidious a thing as coronavirus is, there are some truths it has inadvertently made manifest. No one who contracted the virus knew exactly when or how they became infected. Neither did they know what the outcome of their infection would be, life or death. This is reflective of life in general for all of us, irrespective of coronavirus. Life is precious. Life, we've all learned again, is not something to take for granted. Everyone who became infected had been in contact with someone or something carrying the virus. In wide and divergent places in the world, something that had once been local became global, and everyone became susceptible, proving that despite the often prevalent zeitgeist of self-preoccupation and self-interest, suddenly the world remembered how small it is, how connected we all are, and how the proverbial reverberations of a butterfly in one forest may indeed impact us all. We learned that no one is an island, but that we all share this space, this time, these places together, irrespective of wealth or health. The response that we've all witnessed by professional healthcare and frontline workers, essential and key workers, volunteers and neighbours, has shown that again, despite the general preoccupation with me, myself and I, when the ability to indulge oneself in materialism by commercialism is taken away, people can and will turn to each other, build and develop trust and compassion, and help care for each other. I hope that whatever passes for normal in the future will be shaped not by a return to economic self-interest, a return to materialism and self-preoccupation, but that the goodwill and compassion we have seen manifested globally will be given space to refashion our world into a global village, of our society into communities of caring neighbourhoods. It would be an absolute travesty if the future were only to compound the awful tragedy that coronavirus has been for a few by repeating the mistakes of the past and not taking the opportunity now to transform our world into something different, into something redemptive, into something beautiful, into something new. We know from Brexit, we know from the climate change protests, we know from the way people responded to the coronavirus, that people on all sides of the political and social spectrum want change. This is the time and opportunity to allow that change to happen. Irrespective of left or right, everyone wants a fairer society. Everyone wants the freedom to choose. Everyone wants the liberty to express themselves in harmless ways. And so I appeal to our politicians, locally, nationally, and globally, to facilitate and enable such change to happen, to reprioritize politics as a system of enabling society to be cohesive, compassionate, and create a positive environment for all to flourish. Look at the unity of humanity despite diversity that has been achieved in spite of adversity and work to facilitate that positive energy into a brave new world. This is not the time for retrospective blame. Now is the time for healing. The new normal must not be a return to the polarizing, derisive, and divisive politics of the recent past. Coronavirus has proved there is such a thing as common humanity, and that for all our faults and failings, when it matters, we can be a whole. We can cooperate to effect a common goal, to effect the common good. Please note the evidence and listen to this global voice of a united humanity. May God bless you, and thank you all for this opportunity again to share with you in this holy time, and may we all be transformed and changed for the better.
Thank you so much, Reverend Jerome. Now, before we introduce our final closing video, I just ask those of us who are the panelists who are still with us, if any of you have some final thoughts that you wished you'd said when your turn came round, but didn't, now is your time. Now is the time to say them. All you have to do is unmute yourself and take it away from there. So if any of you have some thoughts you want to share before we introduce the final video, please do so now. Rabbi.
I hope the technical difficulties we have experienced, the kind of polyphony we have been exposed to, is the foundation for a future cooperation in which all the, you know, the disharmony can become a complete harmony together in order to support each other, just like people playing instruments in the same orchestra. Ramadan Mubarak, everyone.
Thank you so much. And just as I've found out how to organize my Betamax video recorder, along comes Zoom. So if anyone else would like to say some words before we close this session, please speak now. I'm just swizzing along to see if anyone's waving at the camera, and I can't see anyone yet. No, if not, then I would like to thank everyone for joining us this evening in this celebration. And John is raising a glass of something that looks remarkably drinkable. We have heard some very inspiring words that should send us away with a song in our heart. If not singing We'll Meet Again or Down the Yellow Brick Road with Judy Garland, something inspiring tonight. We hope, I think everyone who's spoken really hopes, there is a fundamental rethink about how we run our country, our communities, and the globe after this pandemic is over. Because certainly the pandemic has exposed the frailties that are endemic in the way we conduct ourselves. And with those thoughts, I'd like just to round off by inviting our controller, who I thank, who's tackled all the technical issues for us, and thank him for that, and allow him to introduce the final video. Thank you. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Francis, and during lockdown I'm trying to find lots of creative things to do with baby Daniel. And we've had lots of good ideas from my friend Laura for music and sensory activities to do together.
Hi, I'm Nancy Platts, leader of Brighton and Hove City Council. During lockdown I've been upcycling this little desk that I bought from the flea market in Kemptown.
Hi there, I'm Jane and I'm using this COVID crisis as an opportunity to get on with some painting, and where could be better than one's own back garden.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome. This is Tamkin Riaz. During lockdown COVID-19 I'm at home, but I still keep my routine in after five. Then I'll be on FaceTime and WhatsApp and Skype, etc., talking to the children, grandchildren and friends. So that's me, yeah, lockdown. Keep yourself healthy and wealthy. Your health is your wealth.
I'm staying home making English paper-pieced patchwork quilts. Here's the one I'm working on at the moment, made of old curtain fabrics. There's some of the papers. And this is one I made a while ago from old shirts. It's a great way to recycle fabrics and is also a very good way of staying calm and creative.
Assalamu alaikum. My name's Ajay Hussain. I live in Rochester. I came out here to Pakistan in South Kashmir. End of February, actually. So people are occupying themselves with reading, zikr, Quran, but also daily life goes on. So this is what it's all about here.
I'm Max Farah. My escape from the lockdown is the beautiful park in Leeds called Roundé Park, and looking at the swamps.
My name's Annalisa Dodds. I live in Oxford, where I'm one of the Members of Parliament. I've been asked to take part in this project by one of my constituents. I think as we stay at home, it's really important that we look out for others. And I've been so impressed by all the work that's going on to do that. Whether it's ringing an elderly neighbour or offering to help somebody out with their shopping, there's so much that communities are doing together. Let's keep that going, even after we get out of this crisis.
Hi everyone, my name is Iffy, and this is a quick message just to say thank you to everyone who has been supporting their communities, looking after the vulnerable and supporting the NHS. And please, please, please continue to stay at home so it can enable us to fight coronavirus and flatten the curve.
Thank you very much to all of you for joining us. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,